Welcome everyone. So the speaker today is Raphael Ponge from Tsinghua University, and he's going to talk about the tangent groupoid of a Carnot manifold. Go ahead, please.
Okay. All right, thanks for giving me the opportunity to speak in this seminar. So my main result essentially is to give a differentiable version of Mitchell's theorem on the tangent cone of an equirregular sub-Riemannian manifold. I will select an extension of Ponsu derivative to smooth map between Carnot manifold, and this involves some refinement and notion of privileged coordinate, which I'm going to explain. So the main tool going to use, it's used in this talk is only Taylor's formula. And the contents are, so there will be basically five parts. So essentially, the first two parts are some known, probably known to some people already. Privileged coordinates are also known. And then the main new result will be in the last two parts. So what I mean by Carnot manifold, this is also what is called a filtered manifold. So it's a manifold M, which is dimension N, which is equipped with a filtration of the tangent bundle, which is compatible with the Lie bracket of vector field. So there are various examples of Carnot manifold. So one example is that of a step R radiated nilpotently group, which means that as a Lie algebra is it's graded. So and gradient in sense, and so you have a gradient and a direction decomposition. This is compatible with the Lie bracket of the algebra. So by left translation, can each component GW of degree W generate a vector bundle? So the left invariant vector bundles. Basically, this is a the value of the it's given by the value of the left invariant vector fields that are generated by element of GW. Okay, so if take the direct sum of the first W vector bundles, okay, obtain another vector bundles, which give a filtration of the tangent space of G, which is compatible with the Lie bracket. And so this way you get a Carnot manifold. I went fast. And we say that you have a Carnot group when actually the homogeneous component are generated by a Lie bracket with a degree one component. It's called a Carnot group. The definition is due to Ponsu. So another example is equirregular Carnot Carl Theodoric manifold, so in short, ECC manifold. So it's a Carnot manifold whose filtration is generated by the first component, first term in the filtration, that is by H1. Okay. So examples include Carnot groups, contact manifolds, and their generalization. So you have different type of generalization of contact manifold. So that include polycontact. So it's basically and also a polycontact. So polycontact and polycontact are step two examples. Polycontact means that the normal direction at every point, every normal direction is contact. So that include, for instance, MITV group. Polycontact means that so that's why introduced by Apostolov and Ewell. It means that at every point there are at least one normal direction that is contact. So examples of polycontact manifold include product of contact manifolds. Other examples of ECC manifolds so include real upper surfaces in complex space, more generally Cauchy-Riemann. So you have to assume it's non-nearly flat. And various in a parabolic geometry you have many instances of ECC manifold. Other examples include Engel manifolds, which are a step three example. Okay. So So other examples include foliations. So basically, if your foliation means that you have sub-bundles, H1 is involutive, sense of Frobenius, and so this way you get Carnot manifold. Another example, to start with an ACC manifold, and it takes the product with A. Then you get also, you can construct a filtration H tilde 1 dot H tilde A, so that H tilde 1 is H1, and for W greater than or equal to 2, H tilde W is HW plus TR. Okay. So this gives a filtration of the tangent bundle of M cross R. And this is, so we get a Carnot manifold, but it's not an ECC manifold. And this example appears, for instance, when you look at the heat equation on a ECC manifold. So look at the heat equation associated with the sub-Laplacian. Yes? Sorry? Okay, can I go on?
Yes, I think it was just a mistake.
Okay, thanks. Right, so associated with filtration, we have can construct the grading of the, can construct corresponding grading. So we'll see that in fact, this defines the algebra structure on the fibers. Okay, so a grading is a, so it's noted the fract GM. So it has R components. So a component degree W is a quotient of HW by HW minus 1. And this result, which goes back to Tanaka, that the Lie bracket of vector fields defines a bilinear map, bilinear bundle map, sorry, from GWM cross GW prime M with value in GW plus W prime M. Okay, so we define this way. So basically, if you look at the, if you take two sections of X and X prime of HW and HW prime, I look at the value at A of its Lie bracket of X and X prime. So its value modulo HW plus W prime minus one depends only on the value of X and X prime at A. And this way you get a unique bilinear bundle map. Well, it goes back to Tanaka. And this, so using this bilinear bundle map, you can construct a bilinear bundle map on G, frac GM, okay, as follows, so as follows. And it turns out this is a Lie bracket, the algebra bracket, so you get a bundle of graded nilpotent algebra of step R, okay, and see the smooth bundle. So let's go back to Tanaka. And by using, so we call it the tangent Lie algebra bundle of MH. So from the tangent Lie algebra bundle, you get tangent group bundle. So define GMA A. So this is a tangent group at A. So it's a Lie group whose Lie algebra is frac GMA. So basically, this is a frac GMA equipped with Dynkin product given by this. Okay. So essentially, so the group and the Lie algebra are the same manifolds, okay? But and so essentially means so you require the exponential map to be identity. Okay. So this way you get a smooth bundle of graded and nilpotent Lie group examples. So if G is a graded nilpotent Lie group, so at every point the tangent group can be identified with G. And so the tangent Lie group bundle in this case is a triol. This is basically, this is a product G cross G. So I introduce notion of weight sequence. So it depends on the, okay, so, so it's W1, W, dot, Wn. So Wj is the mean of J that are less than or equal to rank of Hw. So for maybe it's best to give an example. So I suppose that M is R4 and you have filtration H1, H2, H3. So H1 is spanned by generated by two vector, X1 and X2. H2 is spanned by H1 and the bracket of X1 and X2. Okay. H3 is TR4. So in the case W1 and W2 are equal to 1. W3 is 2. Okay, and W4 is 3. So basically, so here it's degree. So the idea is that X1 and X2 have degree 1. X1, the bracket of X1 and X2 has degree 2. And the bracket of X1 with the bracket of X1 and X2 has degree 3. So this is defined using a weight sequence. I define anisotropic dilations on Rn. So essentially, it means that so I use two notation for the dilation, depending on considering the map for some kind of dilation. So delta x or t dot x. So basically, xj is scaled by t to the wj. So x1 is scaled by, tw1, x2 is scaled by tw2, etc. Xn is scaled by tw. So I say, well, no. Okay, so call up to the norm continuous functions, which is non-negative, and so that it is positive from x and 0, and it is homogeneous with respect to the, in the sense, with respect to the anisotropic dilation defined in previous slides. So for instance, you can take this pseudo norm. In fact, all the pseudo norms are equivalent. So what? So in fact, the precise pseudo norm is not important for the talk. So in what follows, we fix some pseudo norm. So I need to explain a bit of anisotropic expansions. So I need to do it for functions, vector value map, and vector field. So I say that function, scalar function is homogeneous of degree m if f of t dot x is tm f of x. Okay. And we have an isotropic Taylor expansion in terms of homogeneous polynomials. And where homogeneity is meant with respect to this weighted homogeneity notion. So, okay, so one way to state this is that if you look at ft dot x, is going, when t goes to zero, you're anisotropic in TL FL x, where component FL is a homogeneous polynomial of degree L. So basically, this is the Taylor component of homogeneous degree, weighted homogeneous degree L. And in particular, you have this approximation near x equals zero in terms of pseudo norm that we have fixed. So we can extend this to vector valued map. So consider vector valued map. So assume, so for simplicity, assume.
One question.
Sorry?
In the previous slides, why before the sum you put, you didn't put an equality, but you put sim echo in the first sum. Is this an equality?
No, sorry. It's an asymptotic expansion.
Okay.
No, it's not. Well, it's, so this, but this and this are basically equivalent.
Okay, this one. Okay.
So it's an asymptotic expansion as t goes to zero. So an asymptotic expansion in terms of, so that will be the Taylor part, which is weighted homogeneous of degree. Mm-hmm.
Okay, okay.
No, it's not any, well, it's not, no. Well, it's, okay, it's a meditation for asymptotic expansion. Yeah, so basically you group together the term which are the same weighted homogeneity gives.
Okay, yes.
That's, yeah. Well, yeah, we need only to, so you need to extend to a vector value map and vector field. So of course, you can see a vector field are vector value map. So basically, the two are equivalent. Anyway, so let's do for vector value map first. So we consider a vector value map theta with component theta 1 dot theta m. Okay, so it's W homogeneous of degree m. So W stands for weighted homogeneity. If it satisfies this property, so look, so basically you see this guy is a pullback of theta by the dilation by t. So theta of t dot x, which is rescaled by t minus 1, is tm theta x. Okay. And we say that theta x is big O w of x w plus m if each component is theta j is the big O of x w j plus m. So basically the w here stands for the w j. So w j theta j is a big O of x w j plus m. So the exponent here increases with j, increases with j. Okay. And what it means is that, so it means that t inverse delta tx is a big O of tm as t goes to zero. And in fact, you get an asymptotic expansions, okay? T inverse theta tx, asymptotic expansion. As TL, theta L, what style is a polynomial and W homogeneous of degree L. And L start at, a priori start at is greater than or equal to minus R. So here we need to remember this definition because we're going to use it later. Okay, so we can extend this to vector fields. So again, you can see vector fields are vector value in the map. So we say that the vector field is homogeneous of degree m if delta t is pullback of x by delta t is tmx. Okay, so example of homogeneous vector fields of degree minus wj. So for instance, dxj is homogeneous of degree minus j. And more generally, if you add to ddxj vector field of this form. So here ddxk has is homogeneous of degree minus wk. But if you add, if x alpha is homogeneous of degree wj minus if x alpha is homogeneous of degree wk minus wj, when you get this vector field is homogeneous of degree minus wj. So you get an asymptotic expansion of vector fields as for delta t star x as t goes to zero in terms, so here you have t to VL and xl is a vector field, which is polynomial and homogeneous of degree L. Okay. So we'll say that X has weight W if component of degree L less than W vanish, okay? And if the component of degree W is non-zero. So in particular, this implies that TW delta T star X is equal to the component of degree W up to a big O of T. Okay. So to construct the privileged coordinate, you need notion of H frame. So H frame is a frame x1 dot xn of tm such that xj is in hwj minus hwj minus 1. So it means that the frame are going to give a basis of each of the sub-bundles that are in the filtration. So for instance, if g is an nilpotent ready the regroup with the algebra G, with component G1.gr. So you start with a graded basis of G, okay? So E1.en, so with EJ is in GWJ. If you let XJ be the left-hand vector field such that XJ is equal to EJ at zero, then the x1.xn is a left invariant H frame. So privilege coordinate. So if you consider an H frame x1.xn near point A in M, you say that coordinate center dot A, okay, are privilege coordinate if xj zero is dd xj. Okay, so zero is the coordinate of A. And xj has weight minus wj. So there are various constructions of privilege coordinate, okay, by various people. So you have polynomial privilege coordinate by Grachev, Sarychev, Belech, and Stephanie. So, and we extended the construction to Carnot manifolds. We have a canonical coordinate of first kind of Goodman and Rothschild Stein, so given by this exponential map. And a canonical coordinate of a second kind from Bianchini, Stefani, and Hermes, which is given by this exponential map. Okay, so these are extensions of canonical coordinates on the groups. So given privilege coordinate at A, can we get since by definition, okay, xj has weight minus wj. So the limit here exists, okay? And you denote the limit by xj sub A within parentheses, and call it the model vector field of xj. And it's a polynomial on vector field, which is homogeneous of degree minus wj. So the fact is that the model vector field generates a span, in fact, Lie algebra. So the span of the model vector field is closed under Lie bracket or vector field, so you get a Lie algebra. And so there is a unique group law on Rn, so that if you denote by Ga the corresponding group, then fract Ga is a Lie algebra of left invariant vector field on Ga. And of course, Ga is a graded nilpotent Lie group. So Ga equipped with this left invariant Carnot manifold structure is called the nilpotent approximation of MH at A. So the remark is that this nilpotent approximation depends on the privilege coordinate. So you can get intrinsic nilpotent approximation by using Carnot coordinate. So what's the Carnot coordinate? So basically this okay, so we start with so before I get to this, I need to do some identification. So suppose x1.xn is an H frame near A. So it's going to define a graded basis of the Lie algebra, tangent Lie algebra, frac GMA. And so it's going to provide a global coordinate on frac GMA, and hence it's going to provide global coordinate on G tangent group. Okay, so we can regard the tangent group as having Rn as underlying manifold. Okay, and denote by xg a without parenthesis the left invariant vector field on GMA, so that xg0 is dd xg. So we say that coordinate centered A are Carnot coordinate, so basically they satisfy the first two conditions for being a privileged coordinate. And the extra condition is that requires a model vector field to be the left invariant vector field xj. So in this condition, privileged coordinates are Carnot coordinate if and if the nilpotent approximation agrees with the tangent group. Again, this is modulo this identification of the tangent group. And second, whenever you have privileged coordinates, it's not complicated to get coordinates. You simply use the following change of variables. So make change of coordinates given by this exponential map. So example of Carnot coordinates. So if we work in a graded nilpotent regroup with left invariant H frame x1.xn, So global kernel coordinate system at point A and G, given by this. So basically, you consider this exponential map, okay? Okay, and composed with the left multiplication by. So that will be a kernel coordinate, okay? Kernel coordinate of the first kind of Goodman and Rothschild-Stein are kernel coordinate. Sorry, canonical coordinate of the first kind of Goodman and Rothschild-Stein are kernel coordinate. So they are given by this change of coordinate. So in fact, this example, the gradient-nilpotent Lie group example is a special case of this example. On the other hand, canonical coordinate of the second kind are never kernel coordinate unless you have a nilpotent, unless the group, unless in case of foliation, that is the tangent group is abelian. And in general, the polynomial free coordinate of Belesch are not kernel coordinate. But as I explained in the previous slide, you can always convert privileged coordinate into kernel coordinate by means of this exponential map. So by applying this process to the Belesch polynomial privileged coordinate, we get kernel coordinate, which we call epsilon kernel coordinate. Okay, so we can give a characterization of this. So basically, it will be a polynomial change of coordinate, which has some property. But what's important for us is that the change is going to depend smoothly with respect to A. Okay. So call them epsilon kernel coordinates. So we can describe them in case of gradient nilpotent Lie group with left invariant H frame. So you have a global coordinate system on G given by this exponential map. Okay, and this coordinate, so epsilon kernel coordinate, are given by the group law. Okay. So group law, except instead of having X product of X and X, this is product of Y inverse with X. Okay. And this is actually a first, and in general, we get actually a first order approximation by the, fin, we get a first order approximation in the sense or in the weighted sense of the epsilon kernel coordinate map by the group law of the tangent group. So more precisely, we consider a kernel manifold and an H frame x1 dot xn near A. In any coordinate at A, okay, the kernel coordinate map epsilon y x is approximated by the group law of GMA. Okay, so you get big O W. So it means that you get this in terms of scaling by T. And furthermore, the map depends smoothly on X, or it's polynomial in X. So, and also it depends smoothly in respect to Y. Okay, so you see here that the group law appears as a first order approximation. Okay, so I think I'm relatively on schedule. So next, I would like to we're going to find a kernel notion of kernel differential, okay, which is going to generalize the Pansu derivative. So that will be for kernel manifold map. So what's a kernel manifold map? So it's a map between kernel manifolds that are going to just compatible with the filtrations. Okay. So that is the component, the W component of the filtration is mapped to the W component of the filtration on the oversight. So I recall that so GWM, this is a HW mod HW minus one, and GM is a direct sum of the GWM. So because it preserves the filtration, because the differential, so if phi is a kernel manifold map, the differential preserves the filtration. So it's going to map the graded, so you're going to introduce a map between the component, homogeneous component of the grading. Okay, so you're going to map going to map GWM to GWM prime. And so this way you get a graded vector bundle map, okay, which is going to noted phi hat. Actually, it's a notation is phi hat prime, but apologize for the typo. And okay, so you get a graded vector bundle map. And in fact, this is it's compatible with the LibreCat. So you get a map of Lie algebra. So you get each fiber, you have a Lie algebra map. And it's smooth, so you get a smooth Lie algebra bundle map. Okay. And recall that the product of the, each fiber on each, over each point, the tangent group DMA is Lie algebra, tangent Lie algebra, okay, equipped with the Ligain product. So by functoriality, we get a smooth the differential of the map phi hat prime is also each fiber, between each fiber is also the group map. Okay, and call this map the Carnot differential of phi. So this construction is functorial. So namely, the Carnot differential of composition is a composition of the Carnot differential. So I wrote here. And if you have a Carnot manifold diffeomorphism, so meaning a Carnot manifold map and its diffeomorphism, then the Carnot differential is invertible. And it's this is the Carnot differential of inverse of phi. And get the tangent approximation result as follows. So suppose you have a Carnot manifold map, okay? And in any coordinate at A in M, any coordinate at phi A, okay? So you work in a Carnot coordinate here. The map phi X is approximated by the Carnot differential, okay? And approximation is in the big O W sense. That is, if you like, in this sense. Okay. But starting working in a Carnot coordinate, that you obtain an approximation by Carnot by the group map. Okay. If you work in privileged coordinates, in general, this is approximation you get is only a Lie algebra map. So this is that appears in the article of Belesh in the sub-Riemannian geometry. So to get this approximation result, it's important to work in Carnot coordinate. Okay, and so let me explain the relationship with the Pansu derivative. So Pansu derivative is defined on a Carnot group. More generally, you can define on a gradient nipotent Lie group. So if you have a gradient nipotent Lie group, so it's the algebra is gradient, and the gradient is going to define anisotropic dilations. So this anisotropic dilation are Lie algebra map, okay? And they give rise to a group automorphism of G. So Pansu derivative is fine as follows. So phi is a map from G to G prime, where G and G prime are both step R gradient potent group. So if A is a point of M, then the Pansu derivative, the map from G to G prime, which is defined by this formula. So, okay. So a case where G is abelian, or if like G is Rn with its abelian structure, okay, it's exactly the definition of the derivative. And of course, the limit need not exist, but the result of Pansu say that if G and G prime are Carnot group, and phi is locally Lipschitz continuous, so with respect to the corresponding Carnot coordinate metric, okay? Then the Pansu derivative exists almost everywhere and is a group map. So in fact, if you do a suitable identification, in a case of, so if you suppose that phi is a Carnot manifold map between step R gradient nipotent Lie group, then the Pansu derivative exists for all points. So here, in fact, it exists because in a way you assume the map is smooth. So you can relax the smoothness condition. Anyway, for simplicity, assume it is smooth. And what we like to say is that under natural trivializations, the Pensée derivative agrees with the Carnot differential. So, as I mentioned before, in a case of gradient nipotent Lie group, so here GG is a notation for the tangent Lie group bundle of G. Okay, so this is a trivial bundle which is isomorphic to G cross G. So basically, the trivialization is by left translation. Okay, so you have similar trivialization for G prime, and under this identification, Pensée derivative agree with the Carnot differential. So you can also, for ECC manifold, that is equiregular Carnot character ordering manifold, you can also identify the Carnot differential with the Margulis Mostow differential of quasi-conformal map. So I didn't write the details in the paper, but I think this is true. Again, you have to do some identification between the way Margulis Mostow defines the tangent group, okay, and the way we define the tangent group. But I think we actually wrote, we actually give the identification in one of our paper, Margulis Mostow. Okay, so now I will explain how you can construct a tangent groupoid of a Carnot manifold. So they will show that in fact you can get a smooth deformation of a manifold to its tangent group. Okay. And motivations, part of the motivation stems from the tangent groupoid of a manifold which was constructed by Kahn. Okay. So the motivation of Kahn was to give a new proof of the Atiyah-Singer index theory. So well, it's a bit technical, well, it's either abstract or technical to define a groupoid. So I'll give only a partial definition of a groupoid, okay, which is sufficient for our purpose. So you can think of a groupoid as a set together with a partially defined group law. Okay. So it means that you have a group law which is defined only on a subset of G cross G. Okay. So the definition of the domain of the group law is denoted G2. Okay. So I give so there are two main examples of pair groupoid. We have two main examples of groupoid for this talk. In science, groupoid interpolates between set and groups. So you can see this in the two examples I'm going to mention. So first example is a pair groupoid. Okay, so start with a set X, okay, and the product X cross X is a groupoid, okay. So where the product is given by this, so we find the product, we need the coordinate, the first, the coordinate here and the coordinate here to match, okay. Okay, so define on pair, on pair of pairs x, y, w, z, where x is equal to, y is equal to w. Okay. Another example is a group bundle over space x. Okay. So group bundle, so g is the total space of the group bundles. So basically, you have a group row, but it's defined only if g and h are in the same fiber. All right, so that's the definition at the level of set theory. Here we like to put some differentiable structure. So differentiable groupoid, so it's a groupoid G. So such that basically G is a smooth manifold. G2, the domain of the group law, is an embedded submanifold of G cross G. And the group law is a smooth map. So, example, if you look at the pair groupoid associated with a manifold, that will be a differentiable groupoid. And in case of smooth Lie group bundles over a smooth manifold, you also get a differentiable groupoid. Okay. So const tangent groupoid. So we define. So I define as a set, and then we explain how to get to give a topology and to give a differentiable structure. So we start with a smooth manifold of dimension n. So the tangent groupoid is a disjoint union of Tm and m cross R star. Okay, so I will give another description in the next slide. Okay, so a domain of the product of the group law implication is Tm2 union G2 star. So G2 star is basically domain is so triplet x, y, t, z, y, z, t, so that, okay, I forgot, yeah, okay. So so here the second entry here match, sorry, the first entry here, okay? And so that will be on the M, so this differential multiplication map on the M cross R star map. Okay, so it's a bit like a pair groupoid, except with extra variable T and Tm2. So so this consider a pair of tangent pair of tangent vector, which are in the same fiber. So multiplication is given by this formula. So x, y, t, product of x, y, t, and y, z, t is simply z, t. So is get rid of y, okay? And product of x, v, x, w, this is x, v plus w. So here, v and w are both tangent vector x and take versa. So another way to see that is tangent groupoid is as a disjoint union parameterized by R of the, so at zero you get tangent space, and outside 40 different from zero you get a copy of M cross N. So in fact, the representation from a previous slide, the M cross MT, this is basically M cross M, see the fiber, the slice at T. So we can see that as a, we can see a set level, set theoretic level, you can see that as a copy of a pair groupoid. But I'm going to do in the next slide, going actually to scale distance by so an M cross MT. So that as a differentiable level, this will be basically M cross M, where the distance are scaled by T inverse. In the charts, so corresponding, and so that will be some kind of zoomed version of M cross N.
I'm sorry, can I ask a question?
Yes.
What is the base? What is the source and the target map? At least where it goes.
I didn't want to go into the details, but the base is M cross R.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I think I understand. Yes, thank you. Yeah. So the topology of GM. So it's such that inclusion of TM. So okay, right. So you have two parts. Okay, you have TM and M cross R star. So TM and M cross R star are both, so R star is R minus zero. Okay. They are both manifold on their own right, okay, and topological space as well. So for topology requires inclusion of TM to G to be a topological being. Requires an inclusion of G star, which is M cross R star into G to be a topological embedding as well. And you glue the two components. That means that the following topology, which is such that if you have a sequence XL, YL, TL in G star converging to tangent vectors, okay, it means that XL converge to X, okay, XL converge to X, YL converge to X, TL converge to zero, and 1 over TL K kappa YL minus kappa XL converge to V in in any local coordinate. So what in terms of shard? So basically it means that 1 over TL XL minus YL minus XL converges to V in any local coordinate. So you can write this in terms of shards. And shards, you get this condition. Okay. And get a differentiable structure as follows. So it requires the inclusion of G star, M cross R star into G to be a smooth embedding. Okay. And shards near a tangent space, TM X zero, at point X zero. Okay. Is given by this. So here kappa is any local shard near X zero. So for T different from zero, what you get is a map is kappa X T inverse kappa Y minus kappa X T. Okay. And if T equal to zero, gamma kappa XV is kappa X KX V. So just here, so if you fix X and fix T, so basically what we do here, that we square the distance to X by T inverse. Okay. So it's some kind of zoom version of M, but if you fix X and T. And result of Cohn is that this is actually a differentiable group weight. So it means that this defines a manifold and G2 is a sub-manifold and you have a smooth group law. Okay. So it means also that you have a smooth deformation of a group weight of the pair group weight M cross M into TM. And since done the framework of group weight, we will cover this way the vector bundle structure of TM. Okay. So I want to explain that you have a similar result for Carnot manifold. So before, as I mentioned before, Cohn used the tangent group weight to give a new proof of the Latia Singer index frame. That was his main motivation. So, so let me recall the theorem of Mitchell. So if M is an ECC manifold equipped with a sub-Riemannian metric, then the Gromov-Hausdorff sense, you have a tangent cone at every point A of M. And tangent cone, so if you look at, usually stated in terms of tangent group, okay? If you look at the proof of Mitchell, what you actually get is tangent Lie algebra, okay? Which then identified with a tangent group. Okay, so in fact, it's not the, okay, so I wrote the tangent graph, I wrote the tangent Lie algebra, but in fact, this is an important approximation that we get. So thing is tangent cone, so you're going to give the homogeneous structure, okay, the dilation, but it doesn't provide the group structure. So there was a question of Belesh asking why tangent space of an CC manifold, actually a sub-Riemannian manifold must be a group. Okay, and he also suggested that I could understand this in terms of an analog of Cohn's tangent group. Okay, so it's going to explain here now, okay? So, okay, so start with a Carnot manifold. This tangent group is defined as follows. So it's similar to the construction of the tangent group weight of an ordinary manifold, except you replace the tangent space by the tangent group bundle. Okay. Exactly this. So G2, the domain of the implication map is defined similarly. So basically, you have you get same on M cross R star. You have the same G2 star. Okay. Okay, you want entry, second entry here to match the first entry here. And for GM2, so that will be also a tangent element that are in the same fiber. And you define an implication. So on the R star parts as defined as before, so in a pair group with a pair group with part, right? So XYT product XYT and XZT is XZT for T different from zero. Okay, so we get rid of the Z, the Y here and here. And the product of X, XI and X eta, this is basically you take the fiber product on on the tangent space, tangent group at X. So to define the topology and the differentiable structure, we need to, cannot choose any chart. So you can consider, well, can use any chart, but we need an extra piece of data. So consider what's called an edge chart. So the local chart together with an edge frame. And as I mentioned before, when you have, so the local charts define a coordinate. And as I explained before, whenever you have a when you have local coordinate, you can make a change of coordinate, okay, to get a Carnot coordinate. So the epsilon, so this depends on the choice of the edge frame. So we're going to denote by epsilon y kappa x, the epsilon Carnot coordinate with respect to the edge frame x1 dot xn. And define the topology using this H chart. Okay, so topology of again, G the, as two pieces, GM and M cross M cross R star. So you require the inclusion of GM into G to be a topological embedding, and so requires inclusion of G star, which is M cross R star, into G to be a topological embedding as well. And the second X, Y, TL in G star converges to a point XI in the tangent group bundle. If only if XL converges to X, YL converges to X, TL converges to zero, and you have this convergence, okay? Which in the case where, which in the case of ordinary manifold amount to the same that I mentioned in case of the tangent group width of the cone. Okay. And define differentiable structure in such way that the inclusion of G star into G is a smooth embedding. And for any point X0 in M, any local chart kappa near X0, local chart near the tangent group at X zero is given by these charts, okay? So what you do is that you use this Carnot coordinate associated with kappa, okay? And you basically rescale the distance to X by the anisotropic dilation, okay? So this is what the formula means in a sense. And t equals zero, basically this is x, so gamma kappa xv, it's kappa x, k prime at x, xi zero. So kappa prime at, this is a Carnot differential. Okay. And the result is that if MH is a Carnot manifold, and the tangent group width GHM is a differential group width, and that means that you have smooth deformation of group width of the pair group width of M cross M onto the tangent Liou group bundle. And this allows to recover the Liou group bundle structure of G. So this proves that you have like a tangent cone in a differentiable sense, and it shows how to get the group structure of a tangent group. And in addition, here we work with Carnot manifold, so you cannot use Carnot characteristic. So you don't have a Carnot characteristic metric a priori. And so you cannot speak about Gromov-Hausdorff distance. Okay, so I'm done with the talk. So I'll finish with further remark. So I've been. So we posted a preprint, I should have said before. So this is a joint work with my former PhD student, Wu Chol Chui. So we posted a preprint in 2015, but after, so our paper was published in several years later in 2019. But in the meantime, other people produced alternative construction of a tangent group of a Carnot manifold. So they include papers by Werner Pumken, Al Saidi Sadegh Hickson, and Omar Mohsen. Okay. And there are two applications of the tangent group construction. One concerns the differential calculus on Carnot manifolds. So with using a Lie group with a general any algebraic with a general construction of differential operators. And what Van Erp and Juncken showed is that if you specialize this construction to the tangent groupoid of a Carnot manifold, we recover the differential calculus on a filtered manifold of mini, part of the calculus, that is. And Mohsen proved an analog of the Attias Singer index theorem for hyperelliptic operator on a Carnot manifold. But this is an index theorem at the level of K theory. Okay. So it's not, you don't have a geometric index formula yet. And I finish with a reference for our paper. So there are three papers. So first paper where we basically presented the student tangent groupoid Carnot differential, was published in differential geometry and application. And we have two papers in GDCS where we dealt with privileged coordinate and Carnot coordinate. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Rafael. Thanks.